Here.
Hi everyone, I'm Megan.
I'm Stacy.
And welcome to our latest session of the California ACC FIT for Fellowship, a survival guide for the first year fellow. We wanted to welcome you back if you're joining us again. And for those of you who are new, we welcome you as well.
All right, I think everyone mostly here knows the drill. So I'm gonna go ahead and jump straight to introducing our speaker for today. Our speaker today is Dr. Gagan Singh. He is an associate professor for the Department of Internal Medicine, also the director for the fellowship at UC Davis in cardiovascular medicine. He's the director for clinical cardiovascular research unit. Dr. Singh received his medical degree from New York Medical College, and he completed his internal medicine residency at Stanford University. He did a fellowship in cardiovascular disease as well as interventional cardiology from the University of California Davis Medical Center. And he is a member of the American College of Cardiology and Society of Coronary Angiography and Interventions. So without further ado, Dr. Singh is gonna talk about STEMI complications, which I think is a great segue from our talk during that last session.
And as a reminder, please make sure to keep your mics muted. And if you do have any questions, please feel free to put them in the chat. And Stacy and I will moderate them at the end and give them to Dr. Singh. So without further ado.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Gagan Singh, and I am an interventional cardiologist at UC Davis Medical Center in Sacramento, California. So a couple of months ago, I was asked to talk about post-STEMI management issues that the young cardiology fellow may come across. And I thought it was important to perhaps discuss more practical issues, because we always talk about some of the more, rare events, but what are some of the more common things that as a fresh fellow right out of internal medicine training, what are you gonna get called about more frequently and kind of how do you approach that kind of patient? We'll talk about the more uncommon stuff, but really some of the common stuff as well. And that's kind of how I structured the discussion for today. So here are the obligatory disclosures, nothing pertinent to what we will be discussing today. So here's kind of a case presentation here. This is a 50-year-old smoker, hypertension, not taking their meds, does not like physicians particularly, has had some digestions or indigestion, I would say, for some time now. And is, like in most cases, his wife forces him to call 911. So called 911, shows up to RER, and this is kind of the page that comes over our phones here at UC Davis, STEMI 911 now, right? And so you drop what you're doing and you kind of start driving into the hospital if you're not already there. In this particular case, looks like it was at 146. Hopefully, we're there in the middle of the day. And we get into the CM in the resuscitation room or in the ER room. And sure enough, there's giant anterolateral ST elevations with inferior reciprocal changes. So, as a ER physician, they recognize that. They call the cath team. Cath team generally comes in. And the cath team usually will not consist of an early first-year fellow. In most places, and certainly not at our institution. But cath lab gets activated, door to EKG within 5 minutes. We do a quick bedside echo, since we happen to be there, yes, 20 or 25% there's an anterior wall hypokinesis. Before the patient's brought to the cath lab, we give them dual antiplatelet therapy, a little bolus of heparin, door to stick within 30, 34 minutes. Patient's in significant distress from discomfort. But holding a blood, a reasonable blood pressure, somewhat tachycardic, which is not surprising, and that's in sinus, and he's sitting okay. And so we get bilateral femoral access. And because we know his EF is 20 to 25%, and perhaps this is a talk for another session, we decide to go ahead and just put his percutaneous VAD in first, or the Impella in first. And so here's some representative images. You see the circumflex, you see the left anterior descending artery knocked out here. And again, as a first year fellow, you're not expected to be able to read full angiograms, but just recognize that there should be a big artery here and kind of the anterior interventricular groove, and there isn't. And then after basically some balloon work and some stenting, this is kind of what it looks like, and notice how there's a percutaneous VAD or an Impella in there. So, you know, we do a PCI to the LAD diet. There's stimulatory flow, as there always is. Everybody's happy. We put the Impella in. Now, this is interesting. This is something that you will come across as an early fellow. Your arterial waveform is flatline. You know, and so this freaks out the nurses sometimes. But you know, the MAPs are in the flatline in the 70s. Heart rate's much better now, 70s, 80s. Patients resting comfortably. There's a little bit of sedation that they got. Sats are 100%, 2 liters, no pressures. Much more comfortable. Patient has some AIVR or accelerated new ventricular rhythm during the case, but no VT. Then you go to the floor, and then the rest of the CAT team goes home. And sure enough, after we finish the case, we send a message to, and I don't know why there's such a huge discrepancy from when the pager went off to when this case finished. But anyway, at 10 p.m., you know, everybody's home, and the error of the CCU fellow, and we've done the case, and the CAT fellow basically texts you and says, hey buddy, just finished the STEMI, it's coming your way, did a PCI, TV3 flow, excellent angio results, Impella's on P-line, he's currently writing it, and this is the medications we give him, and you get this nice packaged, you know, patient that comes up to your unit. Now, you know, there was a time not too long ago where we actually picked up this thing called a telephone, and you paid somebody and they called you back and you actually had a verbal communication about some of these patients. But as I am learning, even I don't consider myself terribly aged yet, but still, there's this favor of texting back and forth now, even for complex patients like this. So I still have a habit of picking up the phone and paging a physician and talking to them, especially about somebody that's critically ill. I would encourage you to do the same, but I wouldn't be surprised if every once in a while you get a phone call or a text page like this and they give you that information. So, you know, everybody's gone on home and you know, you're basically the only fellow there now taking care of this really sick but well-packed patient. You know, and so what are the things you want to think about when you approach this patient at the bedside, right? I would make it a point to look at the CAT film yourself. Even at early in the academic year, you may not know what you're looking at. Perhaps you can ask this nice CAT fellow to sit down with you, to go over the films with you, so you understand exactly where the burden was, where is there any residual disease, is anything jailed, is there low flow, is there distal embolization, could there be some edge dissection? And the answer is almost always no, but you want to be thinking about yourself because you're going to be taking care of this patient, and if something does go down, you want to know what the patient left the cath lab with. Right, you want to get an updated set of labs, you know, make sure you check the CBC, metabolic panel, obviously trend the enzymes. There's been this huge push towards just checking troponins, which is great, right? Sensitive way of doing things, but I still find it very important to check troponins and CKs because it gives me not only the density of the infarct, but the size of the infarct as well. And that'll become important as we talk about some of these complications, mechanical complications later on. You know, get an EKG. I can't tell you how many times I've walked into even my own units the next day, and I ask for the EKG post STEMI, and it for some reason I don't have it or it hasn't been done, and I think that's inexcusable. But check an updated EKG. What does the patient's EKG look like when they land in your unit? Did the STs resolve? Are there Q waves present? Because these are going to be important. During the procedure, probe your cath fellow about, you know, what sort of percutaneous access sites were achieved. Was there any sort of problem with them getting access? You know, are the sheets still there? Are they not? When do they need to come out? Did you guys use a closure device? And what are some of the active medications that are infusing in? So, such as a 2B3A, Cangrelor, not quite honest, in the era of P2Y12, there is not a lot of use of continuous IV medications, but there may be. You know, every once in a while, we may have to reach for it for high thrombotic burden or stent thrombosis or a variety of issues. So be mindful of that. And more importantly, does he have or need arterial monitoring or invasive hemodynamic monitoring, such as a PA catheter? And if a percutaneous support device was used, you know, what is its current position? You know, when the patients land in the unit, they've been shifted around a little bit. So feel free to get a chest x-ray, a bedside formal echo. And then, you know, this is something that you'll develop. I, to this day, develop this and I rely on it, and that's this gut feeling. You know, when this patient lands in your unit, you know, what does your gut tell you about this patient? Is it sick, not sick? You can keep a close eye on him, or this guy looks really stable. You know, he's going to be okay till tomorrow. So anyway, here's scenario number one. I'm actually going to move my thing here so you can actually read that. Okay, so scenario number one says here, you know, 11:15, now closer to midnight, you get a page from the CCU resident, and you're the CCU fellow, so the resident overnight is a PGY2, PGY3, says, hey, by the way, patient's having wide complex tachycardia, and should we cardiovert? And, you know, That's great. You know, obviously, if they're wide complex type cardio and they're unstable, hopefully they're already have cardio worded and then they're calling you. But say if they're stable and you know, as you're waking up at 11:15 or you're walking over there, some of the things you're thinking about are, you know, what are the vitals? If he's unstable, you know, put the phone down, cardiovert, you know, implement ACLS protocol, and I'm coming in, I'm on my way in, I'm walking up to the unit or getting out of bed, whatever you're trying to do. But if he's stable, you know, get a 12 lead, get ready to cardiovert, you know, what are the blood pressures, what are the heart, what are the SATs, how does the patient feel? And those are all going to be important things. So say that here's a wide complex rhythm, which is, again, not uncommon in patients that have been revascularized either. Hopefully in developed nations, you don't see this much, but you may if you work at a center that gets people helicoptered in from really remote regions. But if they receive lytics or even after percutaneous intervention, you get this wide complex rhythm that is not as fast as your typical VT, but it is faster. And what, one of the things that you notice is that the axis is flipped. So this is a ventricular rhythm, but this is accelerated idioventricular rhythm, or AIVR, right? And this is generally secondary to revascularization, and you generally don't need to start antiarrhythmics, nor do you need to cardiovert, right? It's benign. The heart rate can be variable and concurrent to about a quarter of the STEMI patients within the first 24 hours. Now, it's self-limiting, like I said, doesn't require antiarrhythmics. It's just all the potassium, the lactate, everything that's washed into the myocardial bed increases automaticity of the electrical membranes, and as a result, that you may get these. Now, sometimes you can and cannot see the preceding P waves, and are sometimes retrograde P waves, but again, overall not an indicator of adverse prognosis. But then, let me move my camera again here, but then you see a rhythm like this, right? And so now this patient's starting to have more and more kind of salvos of non-sustained VT, and you know, there can be benign occurrences such as just PVCs to non-sustained VT to full-on VT. And you kind of do your standard internal medicine, you know, management practices, right? You do your lights, oxygen levels. You know, if they're having a lot of PVCs and non-sustained VTs, is it due to some sort of intrinsic myocardial irritability from their recent MI, or is it from the device? Then the Impella sometimes is constantly banging against the myocardium can cause PVCs, so it can be difficult to assess. But for patients that are not in shock, you know, you can try to use beta blockers to help suppress this. Usually, not used to suppress PVCs, non-sustained VTs. However, you know, if the PVCs and non-sustained VTs are getting longer and longer and the salvars are getting longer, then antiarrhythmic agents may be useful. So you want to discuss with your CCU attending, you want to be able to discuss with your interventional team if the Impella needs to be adjusted. You know, make sure you get a chest x-ray to make sure that Impella hasn't shifted, or a bedside echo to confirm location. And then kind of try to figure out if it's the device causing a lot of arrhythmias or if it's just the patient. If it's the patient, should you start him on beta blockers, antiarrhythmics? So keep those things in mind. And then, of course, you know, the greatest fear is that a patient degenerates into VT VFib. Now, even though you have had full revascularization, if this is a subacute MI or a patient's, you know, does have a pretty large scar, you know, this, even after full-on revascularization without any sort of, you know, coronary complication, this is, again, something you will see. These patients are highly irritable, and they get these bouts of VT, which may degenerate into VFib, and so they get hemodynamic instability, and this requires urgent cardioversion. Now, once you do cardioversion, you know, there's a cocktail of antiarrhythmics, amiodarone, and lidocaine are usually the first go-to that you consider. Again, beta blockers also, you're definitely discussing this with your CCU attendings and your EP attendings. And the question in your mind is, you know, what is this mechanism? Is it reversible or not? Is there ongoing ischemia? This is where, you know, finding out what happened during the cath. Was there a jail diagonal artery? Was there something that was funny that looked like, you know, an edge dissection? Is that why they're doing this? Is this all due to a high thrombotic burden that went downstream? No, or is it just a really big scar and a really big infarct? And so these are all questions you're having as you take care of the acute, you know, VT episode. That's the easy part. But then the harder part is, you know, what is driving it and what can you do to prevent it from happening again? And again, VT, especially if the Impella is in place, the patients can be relatively hemodynamic stable, but don't sit on it, right? This can degenerate into VFib and can be a problem. So now if you have incessant VT, VFib, despite antiarrhythmics, despite an Impella, now you just may need to totally cut out their sympathetic drive and consider intubating them or putting them on and dropping their sympathetic drive by putting them on propofol. And an occurred error of early revascularization, you know, very rare to, in a setting of STEMI at least, you know, to be, you know, overdrive pacing them or putting them on ECMO. Now you're talking about some of these patients chronic scar coming in. So, you know, overall pearls are stabilized, understand the mechanism, is it benign or pathologic, and think about whether it's induced or spontaneous. Is it induced by the impeller? Is it induced by their kind of overall, you know, metabolic or clinical presentation? And if they have ongoing ischemia, that may need to be addressed. And if the patient doesn't have mechanical circulatory support, do they need it? And part of the biggest thing is call for help and use the antiarrhythmics purposefully. So now let's move on to scenario two. So, right, so it's getting close to midnight. Say the CCU resident called you again and says, hey, listen, we can't really get an arterial waveform from his sheath. You know, he has a femoral sheath in place, and this is what the impeller screen looks like, right? So you get the red is the arterial waveform, which is 88 over 73. This is a motor current again, and currently the impeller is giving full support at 3.5 liters. Again, the impeller discussion is separate, but you get this kind of page, and you're like, holy crap, patient doesn't have any sort of pulsatility, right? I remember reading the textbook once, which said blood pressure should be 120 over 80. This is not 120 over 80. So you have to go to the bedside, see the patient, see what's going on. Is it a mechanical problem with the arterial transducer? Is this a true pressure that you're getting? And if it is, does it make sense? Right? And so patient is sleeping but arousable and saying, hey buddy, I'm doing fine. You know, the cuff pressure corroborates what's going on here. It's 90 over 80. Heart rate's 85, sinus. He looks like a peach, 100% on 2 liters. You do a quick bedside echo, the impeller is in good position, and this is what the screen looks like of the impeller. The question is this okay? And the answer is that this is what a prototypical patient with an acute MI who came in with shock, and once you put the impeller in, the impeller is doing all the work. The LV is recovering, and basically the impeller is providing most, if not all, of the forward flow, and this is what we call the heart is resting. Because if you were to dial back on the support from the perk guide or from the impeller, you would see the pulsatility come back. So this is, again, a common scenario. Most of these patients, you know, they hopefully should be coming to your unit with some sort of invasive hemodynamic monitoring, such as a PA catheter, one Gans catheter. And if you were to take a look at it at this point, you would see, yeah, you know, the blood pressure is quote unquote terrible, right? 88 over 73, and there's no pulsatility to the arterial waveform, but they're not tachycardic, they're sagging okay. And if you look at their hemodynamic data, right, mean right atrial pressure is 10, mean pulmonary artery pressure is 28, wedge is about 17. And the P diastolic wedge is about 17, and index is 2.5, and this is good, right? So this is not a hemodynamic or a Swan-Gans lecture, but hopefully, you know, you guys have some familiarity with what these numbers mean and what the normal cutoffs are. But this is normal. This is good. This tells you that the patient is relatively happy and healthy. The patient is doing fine in the middle of the night. It's probably not just to mess with the P or the power levels on the impeller. This patient is doing well. Now, let's give you a different scenario. Okay, so same patient, slightly different scenario. Again, the pressure is 88 over 73, heart rate. Now patient's a little tachycardic, sagging okay. But now look at the hemodynamic numbers. Mean RE is a little elevated, 15. Mean PSF 28 is 32. PA diastolic is 25. So the wedge is elevated. The PA diastolic is elevated. Your index is still not good. It's 1.6. You look at the urine output, you know, less than 50 cc's an hour in lactate 4. The device is telling you it's pumping at P9. Or it's at power is at P9, and the motor current is good, and it's giving you as much support that it can. But collectively, the hemodynamic data suggests this patient, for some reason, is still not getting all the support that they need. And it's an individualized decision at this point whether you escalate the mechanical support device or you add on pressors. And again, you know, every patient is different, and every CCU attending kind of is different. So. But you need to recognize in this particular scenario, this patient needs something else. So even at midnight, you wake up your CCU attending and you wake up the cath attending and kind of come up with a decision of what you're going to do next. So now let's go to a third scenario, right? And so now this is an inferior MI. So you get, again, you get a patient who's tachycardic. And now, interestingly, what you see is that mean right atrial pressure is 25. That's pretty high. And your PA pressure is 45 over 30 with your index at 1.6, right? And there is something called a PAPI, your pulsatility, your pulmonary artery pulsatility index, which tells you if the right side of the heart is suffering, right? Especially when you have an inferior MI, if there's RV involvement, right? And you look, and the patient's parameters are basically telling you that they're in shock. Your urine output is low, lactate's high, right? So this is a patient who's basically telling you that he needs RV support. And again, there's many different methods of doing that, either pharmacologically or perhaps percutaneously. Again, that's for a separate discussion, but again, you need to recognize when you have parameters like this, use the hemodynamic data in a patient with a crappy arterial waveform who comes to you or a waveform that doesn't, is concerning you. And you have hemodynamic data that doesn't support stability, that something's wrong. You don't sit on this patient. You need to wake up somebody and talk to them that, listen, this patient may need RV support. So, all right, so let's move on from that. We'll head on to scenario number three. Again, these are, again, practical issues that I think you may come across. And I'm trying to build a story for you to think, take a step back, think, use the objective data, and then come up with a plan for these patients. So here's scenario number three. As a group of scenarios in scenario number three. So again, middle of the night, it's just you. You get a call saying, listen, patient's more hypotensive, he's getting more tachycardic. And so then again, same thing. What does the objective data show, right? And you need to try to figure out what this is. You got to think broadly. Is this a fluid problem? Why? Why would all of a sudden you have a fluid problem? I mean, is there not fluid in the pipes? Is it because he's bleeding? Is there an acid-site bleed? Is he having a spontaneous GI bleed or a retroperitoneal bleed? Is this a pump problem, right? So if you're not pumping effectively, that can lead to hypotension in the middle of the night. And this is where you have the SWOG numbers to help. Or is this a low SVR problem? Why would a guy like this all of a sudden have a low SVR problem? Could there be a concomitant infection? So here you have the STEMI that gets totally packaged up to you, shows up to your CCU in the middle of the night. Patient's hypotensive and the right quadrant looks fine. But you know, when you talk to the cath fellow said, oh yeah, by the way, you know, we kind of were treating it as a pincushion this particular, it's July after all, right? So it's an early cath fellow and he's still trying to figure out how to get access. And so he stuck the femoral artery a couple of times before they got it. Patient got fully anticoagulated and whatnot. And so now they're hypotensive. And this is what the hemodynamic data showed, right? A really low right atrial pressure, really low PA diastolic, and the index is terrible. And what this thing is going to hopefully loop here a little bit. And what I want you to do is pay attention here to the right groin. And if you paid attention to the right groin, there's the prosthetic femoral head. But then notice this big glob right here. That's basically a hematoma, and that hematoma that extends retroperitoneally. And so this patient basically had a vascular access site related RP bleed or retroperitoneal bleed, right? And so again, you have to have, especially in these patients that are anticoagulated and on multiple, you know, aspirin, Brilinta, sometimes 2B3A, Cangrelor, you know, they are at risk. And this is why there's a huge push for radial artery heart catheterizations or radial artery use for STEMIs. Now, again, why we didn't use that for this particular case is beyond the scope of this discussion, but for whatever reason, understanding that this patient had femoral access site, now their filling pressure looked really low. Bleeding is the first thing in my mind for when you see these type of patients. So again, hypovolemic, why? You know, what were the filling pressures in the cath lab? If there's a sudden drop, they're losing blood somewhere, right? And so you check the stat CBC, you get type and cross, you get 4 units ready, you give them fluids and do a bedside echo, right? Make sure they're not, it's hard to lose that much volume and have a tamponade. In fact, they can look a little different, but again, you want to start thinking about those things. You want to check your access site for a hematoma or a pseudoaneurysm. If they're on a 2B3 or P2Y12, you know, you want to consider stopping that, or especially if you're on something like Cangrelor, you want to stop that and make sure you let your cath fellow and your attending know. And then, you know, again, same thing, when you get that sign out from the cath fellow, you ask about vascular access. Oh yeah, you know, by the way, when you put in the femoral sheath, was there any sort of issue? Did you have multiple sticks, 4 or 5 sticks, or was it just 1 stick? Those are all things that you want to keep mindful of. And then if the filling pressure were low in the cath lab and they're persistently low, patient may just be dry. And that certainly could be the case. So you give a little bit of fluids, and I would still want to do the above, you know, check your fluids, check your CBC, type and cross. You know, you may not necessarily have to send them down for a CT right away, but keep that kind of in the back of your mind. So here's yet another scenario. Patients hypotensive, a little more tachycardic. Sats don't look too good, 92% on 2 liters, a little worse than what we've had so far. And then if you look at the mean, our atrial pressure is 10, mean pulmonary pressure 28, P of diastolic 16, not too bad, but index is 2.8. right? So patient is hypotensive, and why, right? With an index that's higher than what we've seen so far, despite having an Impella in there, and the patient was so-called allegedly in cardiogenic shock when they came in here. So the physiology here really tells you that patient's gone from a true cardiogenic shock and now starting to develop a low SVR state. And sure enough, you check a temperature, perhaps the temperature is a little bit on the higher side, and people can present with both, right? They can have dueling physiologies going on, and use your hemodynamic data to try to figure that out, right? Not uncommonly, you have patients that are moving around during the case, so they break the sterile field and then touch the vascular access site, and you know, they could be bacteremic, and so you want to, you know, pan culture them, empirically start antibiotics. You may or may not need pressors with alpha activity. And so, again, we discussed your CCU tending. Alternatively, when these patients come in, if some of them are under CPR, there's a risk for aspiration or when they're getting intubated. So again, you want to think about it, empirically start antibiotics, especially if they're developing a low SVR state. And if there's an infectious process going on, you're really thinking about having their tenosynthesis devices removed sooner rather than later. All right, so scenario number four is, it's later again, same thing, and now the nurse is paging you directly, saying that, hey, I tried calling the resident. Resident wouldn't respond back to me. They're admitting a AFib patient in the ER, but I'm a little worried about this guy. He came from the cath lab, and he still has ST elevations on telemetry, right? And you'll get this page all throughout your fellowship. I still get it as an attending. And when I finish a procedure, patients are in the PACU or something like that, and they're like, oh, patient has ST elevations on telemetry. Telemetry can be very misleading. Always get a 12 lead, all right? If the nurse tells you that, always get a 12 lead as you're walking over there, and tell them to have a 12 lead ready. So if the 12 lead still shows persistent ST elevations in a post-STEMI patient, some thoughts, what are you thinking about? You're thinking about, well, what does the patient look like? Is he sleeping? Is he in pain? If he's writhing in pain, and it doesn't always have to be chest pain, right? You're worried. The big worry here is what? The big worry is that, you know, either they didn't revascularize, they were supposed to revascularize, or there's stent thrombosis. It's certainly on the differential here. But the question is, what does the patient look like? Are they sleeping? Are they in pain? What are the vitals? Are they tachycardic or not? And you want to do this clinical and EKG evaluation and also assess the evolution. Did things get better? Did things get worse? Or has this been kind of bad all along? So if you have a case with an approximate LAD subacute MI, so in other words, patient was at home for days, if not weeks, finally something brought him in, and you do an aspiration thrombectomy, a high thrombotic burden, and you PCI, and then, you know, you do distal aspiration, end-hole injections for sluggish flow, right? So when you have microvascular plugging, you know, you can have persistent ST elevation. So here's a patient with kind of queued out anterolateral type MI, and it's kind of acute on chronic, and then even despite you revascularizing them, they still have these persistent ST elevations. It looks like an evolving type EKG. And you know, again, here's a patient that kind of had an acute culprit lesion here in the PROC system, but then after it was revascularized, and the camera's moving around here a little bit, but if you look at it, this isn't exactly TIMI 3 flow. It takes a beat or two beats. And how we grade TIMI flow is, again, a different discussion, but it's not a robust TIMI 3. You know, I call it a 2, 2.5, because it takes several beats for the entire vessel to fill. So suggestive of microvascular dysfunction, probably from all this downstream hit of all this clotted material. So persistent ST elevations, in some cases likely related to microvascular plugging, overall carries a poorer prognosis. But, you know, if the macroscopic vessels have been fully revascularized, your treatment strategy is really supportive care, right? Patients are usually on aspirin, Brilinta, keep them on a 2B3A sometimes, usually not a heparin drip. And you know, you provide support sometimes with a balloon pump or an Impella to help increase coronary perfusion. You support their hemodynamics or electrolytes and their arrhythmias, and over time it gets better. And a lot of the damage, because this was a subacute presentation, is already done. And so it's just a matter of times, and that's kind of your main focus. Now, again, a different scenario. Now you have a subacute anterior MI, status post PCI, right? And in this case, you know, you had full revascularization, you had TIMI 3 flow afterwards, and your EKG on arrival, still has ST elevations, right? And this was the left ventriculogram that you reviewed before the patient, you went home for the night. And notice how the base of the heart is okay, but because it was subacute anterior MI, kind of the anterior apical segment is essentially aneurysmal, maybe even dyskinetic. And so, you know, basically pre-post revascularization, there's some improvement in the ST elevations. This particular patient seemed dynamically stable with improvement in their symptoms. And we looked at that ventriculogram that we just reviewed together, and the bedside echo confirms that really this is just chronic ischemia, aneurysm of the left anterior wall, and that's really what the persistent ST elevations in that case are related to. So again, think, what does a gut feeling tell you? What does a patient look like when you have persistent ST elevations? Those are the two big things: is something meets you urgently, something not. And you know, sometimes just a lot of supportive care is what you need to provide the patient. So let's wrap it up with our final set of scenarios here. You know, this is not uncommon. You patient lands to your CCU in the middle of the night after a STEMI and you know, post PCI, they're complaining of a little bit shortness of breath. You know, your resident calls you, the nurse calls you, you're trying to figure out, well, what is this related to? Is this related to medications? You know, Brilinta, but 1 in 5 patients who get Brilinta will, because it's an adenosine agonist in the pulmonary vasculature, it can cause bronchoconstriction. So some about 1 in 5 patients in the trials at least complained of dyspnea. It's not usually debilitating, and people can usually get through it, but could it be that? Could it be volume? Or did that, you know, in the course of the case, are they volume up? And that's what's causing their dyspnea. Does it have some sort of EQ mismatch? If it's a subacute MI, especially, are you thinking about a mechanical complication, right? And or is it non-cardiac altogether? So if you get the call about dyspnea, you know, and really, you know, update your vitals, look at their hemodynamics, chest x-ray, do a bedside echo, right? So here's a scenario, and you get a patient, and I'm trying to hopefully paint a clear picture for you as to what this is. And so this is a patient with an acute circumflex MI. Now, in the course of their initial diagnostic films, you recognize that the RCA is already occluded and is chronically occluded. And so post revascularization of the CERC, you get excellent flow, T3 flow, and you notice that right is chronically occluded because that left, after you fix the CERC, you know, provides very adequate clot up to the right coronary artery. Now, you know, in the afternoon, you get a page by the fellow and said, or by the resident at this point, the resident says, hey, something's wrong, patient's complaining of really severe shortness of breath. I'm a little worried about him. It doesn't look good. You know, he's got bilateral pulmonary edema, effusion, Swan number suddenly changed. And so you have to recognize what the Swan number showed, right? So mean RA originally was 7, mean PA was slightly elevated, and wedge was okay. But then all of a sudden everything jumped up, right? So you're 17, 44, 25 with the following tracings, right? And these are wedge pressure tracings. These aren't PA pressure tracings. And what you're seeing is the mean wedge is elevated, yeah, about 25 or so. But then this patient has very prominent B wedges. Okay. And so take the time to understand what all the tracings for your hemodynamics look like. Again, that's kind of beyond the scope of this particular lecture. But this is a patient who basically has acute severe MR. And one of the things you're worried about is that this patient has acute papillary muscle rupture, right? And so As an early fellow, you may not know that this is a parasternal long axis view. There's the anterior leaflet, posterior leaflet. And every once in a while, and right now it just may look like black and white fuzz TV to you, but the more and more you see these, the more and more you will recognize that there is something flailing up into the left atrium. When you put color Doppler around there, and there's this very kind of, you know, eccentric and angry looking MR jet. And so this is a patient with an acute papillary muscle rupture. Now, it's rare, usually seen in delayed presentations of an MI, but it can occur in a true acute setting if the previous circulation to the posterior medial papillary muscle is compromised. So in this particular patient, right, even though this isn't the delayed presentation, but the right coronary artery was chronically occluded, so perhaps there was some delayed or there was some chronic ischemia to the posterior medial papillary muscle, and then the CERC finally acutely went down, and that kind of tipped the patient over. And so, you know, the posterior medial papillary muscle, right, it's a single, and this is probably going to be on your boards, right, so pay attention. The posterior, we will get pinned on this at some point, but the posterior medial papillary muscle has a single blood supply, which is why it's the more likely of the two papillary muscles to rupture. On the other hand, the anterolateral papillary muscle is usually supplied by both the LAD and the circumflex artery, so it's less likely to rupture. Now, you can listen for a murmur, but again, in very rare cases, sometimes you may not get a murmur. Some of that may be due to equalization of the pressures and coupled with poor cardiac output, so-called silent MR. transthoracic echo is probably the most helpful. But this is a mechanical problem, right? So medical therapy alone will not work. You need mechanical stabilization. And usually a balloon pump is pretty effective at stabilization. And ultimately, the patient needs for definitive treatment, surgical intervention. Now, as you can imagine, these aren't the healthiest patients when they walk into your CCU. They're on aspirin, they're on Brilinta. Sometimes they're on IV anticoagulants as well. And so, the balloon pump, other mechanical circulatory support devices, and now you say to the surgeon, hey, please take this patient to the operating room. And so they're not so keen. And remember, with medical therapy alone, mortality is 80%. So they're having case reports more and more of transcatheter edge-to-edge repair technologies, such as MitraClip being used in this scenario. So consider that if you're at a center that has that availability, if you happen to see one of these patients, again, overall a relatively rare event, especially in developed nations, but something to think of. So a couple more scenarios and we're done here. And here's another scenario where a patient presents with a subacute LAD STEMI. Right, it's in the afternoon and you get a page again, hey, something's wrong, something suddenly changed. So now let's look at the hemodynamics here. This are the pressures before, this is the pressures now, they're elevated, but this time you don't see V waves. When you do the bedside echo, right, this is what you see. And again, this is what's called an apical four chamber view. And this is a left ventricle, right ventricle, interventricular septum. If you zoom in, what you'll see is that there's a defect here, right? So there's a ventricular septal defect or a ventricular septal rupture. Defect connotates that something that was congenital. That connotates that there's something congenital, but in this particular case, it's really not congenital, it ruptured because of tissue that was disintegrated. So in the community, we call it sometimes ventricular septal rupture as opposed to a defect, but either way, we're connotating the same thing here. And so, right, again, this is rare. This is not as common as some of the other stuff that we talked about earlier in the talk, but it's common in older age patients, female patients with prior CVA or persistent ST elevations, right? They have a higher heart rate or lower blood pressure. That DPDT, the thought is that a higher kilo class. And then again, if you have later or overall lack of reperfusion. So, in terms of which epicardial territories, it's equal in terms of LAD or RCA that contribute to the ventricular septal defect or ventricular septal rupture burden. Now, this is interesting, and this is, again, yet another thing you can use for your cocktail parties, but if it is the LAD, your anterior MI-related VST generally occur a little bit more apically in the interventricular septum, and they're a little bit of cleaner kind of communications, simple like this. On the other hand, when they're inferior MI-related VSTs, get to be a little bit more complex. They're very serpiginous through this hemorrhagic necrotic core. Now, remember, this patient just has had a chronic MI, but there's an acute unchronic component to it. That's why they ended up in your CCU or ended up into the cath lab and then ultimately into the CCU. The tissue here is unbelievably friable. It's like, melted cheese. I mean, it's not thick, tough tissue. And so you can imagine, even if you recognized it, these patients are pretty ill. They're in the unit. Nobody's that excited about doing anything with them. And so it's a mechanical problem. Medical stabilization is usually not effective long-term. You can certainly use a balloon pump in the acute setting to stabilize the patients, but time is your best friend. The more you wait for definitive surgical or percutaneous therapy, and again, which one you use is really, it's a multidisciplinary discussion, right? You have to look at your own center of surgical or percutaneous experience. What do the rims look like? Is it a discrete hollow versus a serpiginous tract? What does the patient's protoplasm look like for surgery? What is their hemodynamic status? Because if you look at this, if you look at acute MI patients with a ventricular septal defect or rupture, right, your mortality, if you take them for any sort of therapy earlier on, you're looking at mortalities that are 50 to 60%. They're really, really, really high. Obviously, if you do nothing, these patients, all of them are going to die. But if you try to take them earlier on, again, there's whether it's percutaneous or surgical, let me go back there. It's not so great. On the other hand, if you delay surgery, if you can somehow find a way to stabilize them enough for a week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, the best. But you also may be self-selecting some patients here, right? I mean, the reason survival or mortality is lower out here is that because everybody else has died. The ones with the bigger defects, the ones with the greater infarcts have died off already. So there might be some selection bias here, but just understand that these are a sick group of patients. Something needs to be done for them, if anything can be done, and the longer you wait, the better it is for them. So here's the final scenario, and then we'll call it a day, and I'll let this play a little bit. So basically, you know, patient comes to your unit, again, a subacute, delayed presentation perhaps, you know, comes, has sudden onset chest pain, becomes hypotensive, and a PE arrest. You resuscitate him with ACLS protocol, and then bedside echo shows this, right? So here's a kind of an apical view. There's a pericardial effusion, and you see this color Doppler showing possibly a communication going all the way out into the ventricular space, right? So this is a free wall rupture. You know, I've been doing cardiology since 2011 now, and so a little over 10 years, and I've never seen this. And so in the era of primary early PCI developed nations, we generally don't see this free wall rupture, probably to the major contributor, those who even don't make it into the hospital. And that's why we don't really see it. And so risk factor, but again, things you're thinking about, it's going to be on your boards. So you want to know about it. Probably not as common as some of the earlier scenarios that we talked about, right? So usually thinking about patients who have, this is their first MI without any collateral flows, anterior lateral infarcts, size of the infarct matters here, and some other risk factors for pre-wall rupture. All right, so what do you do? Well, I mean, if you get back, you know, keep fingers crossed, you transfuse, pericardiocentesis. You know, it's a multidisciplinary kind of discussion. Do you put them on mechanical circulatory support? Again, similar to your ventricular suffo patients, you know, these are not healthy patients. They're pretty sick. And so, you know, and what is the appetite of your surgical program to take somebody like this with very high mortality to begin with? So this is, again, more discussions that you have. So I'll close it out here by saying that, you know, post-ME patients are a really important group of patients. These patients are sick, even if they come fully packaged up for you. So you have to understand what they look like when they get to your unit. Don't just take the computer's word for it. Residents, go see them. Get your gut feeling. Get that visceral reaction to what they look like. And if there is any sort of acute issue that arises, you know, don't try to be the eye doctor, right? And we have iPhones or iWatch and all that stuff. I call it the eye doctor, where you take care of patients sitting in front of a computer that's on the other end of the hospital. Go to the bedside. You can't replace that, at least not yet. But go to the bedside, evaluate their hemodynamics, look at their lab, their imaging. What does your gut tell you? And then you come up with a plan for the management. Complications can be rare to frequent, benign versus lethal, right? And so you need to develop that algorithm in your mind on how you're going to assess for those. And right, our job is to always hope for the best, but we have to prepare for the worst. So, which is why we talk about some of these rare events. But also I want you to be familiar with the more common ones. And for all complications, stabilize the patient, call for help early, and then keep attending, notify of the patient's progress, and use the objective data, okay? All right, I wish everybody the best and good luck, and please ask me questions.
Fantastic. Thank you very much, Dr. Singh, for an excellent presentation. We are going to move now to the Q&A section. So if you, if there are any more questions, please feel free to put them in the chat, and both Stacey and myself will moderate that. And thank you, Dr. Singh, for joining us. We really appreciate it.
Really good to have you.
So let's move right on to the first question. So this is in regards to what you're talking about with either the delayed or the late presenting STEMIs, especially during the COVID era where, you know, some people are not coming into the hospital as frequently as they probably should or they do. The question is, have you seen more of these complications of STEMIs due to the pandemic in itself?
Hi guys, thanks again for letting me give that lecture. You know, so I think at least here, we have not seen a lot of delayed complications, mechanical complications. We've certainly seen a fair number of delayed presentations. Patients have come in sick, they're coming in shock, and it's been really tough to get them out of their shock. But in terms of seeing delayed mechanical complications, so far we have not, at least at our institution, not have seen a great resurgence. And I'm not aware of any large, you know, COVID-related registry that has shown the same either.
I think another question is about ticagrelor side effect. You had mentioned that dyspnea is something that patients can experience. The question is, how quickly do you typically see the onset of side effects? You know, is this something immediate that you would notice as soon as a patients gotten loaded in the cath lab?
Yeah, it's if you look at the clinical trials for that looked at ticagrelor, about 20% of the patients, when they came back for a follow-up, at least in the trials, complained of dyspnea that was assessed by checking pulmonary function tests, chest x-rays, BNPs, and all of that came back negative. And so what, you know, what they concluded was because Brilinta is an adenosine analog, it causes bronchoconstriction and it gives you this sensation, but clinically it's not that that problematic. So I've seen it the next day in some patients, and I've seen it, you know, I've had, I do PCI from a patient that was referred to me from another cardiologist, they'll often go back and see the cardiologist within a couple of days. And I've had the cardiologist call me back and say, hey, this patient's just been complaining of Brilinta complaining of dyspnea. And, you know, we often assume it's related to the Brilinta. We switch them to Plavix and their dyspnea goes away. Some patients, it takes a couple of days. Some patients, it's been the next day, as soon as the next day. So it is a little bit variable in my practice, but I wouldn't be surprised if you get it the next day.
Makes sense. So the next question is essentially expanding on what you were discussing with Impella and shock in these patients. So what do you look at when you're deciding to place an Impella either before or after intervention on the STEMI?
Yeah, you know, it's an area of significant debate and investigation. I think the vast majority of sites will revascularize first and then look to see if the patient needs a percutaneous assist device. And there is currently something called the UNLOAD trial, which is essentially looking at, you know, these type of patients who come in shock, because often, you know, what happens to your LVDP when you're having an acute MI and you're in complete shock? Your LVDP is really, really high. So now all of a sudden you've opened up a vessel, and right, and coronary perfusion pressure is a result of your diastolic pressure and your basically your left ventricular end diastolic pressure, all right? And that is kind of what governs, to some degree, coronary perfusion pressure. Technically, it's your right atrial pressure because that's the end of your coronary sinus tree. But you're, basically, if your LVDP is high and all the other pressures are high, your RA pressure is going to be high as well. So basically, if you have high LVDP and you're somewhat hypotensive, you have low diastolic blood pressures, you're essentially, you know, kind of affecting coronary perfusion pressure. So despite you revascularizing your patient, you know, because the coronary perfusion pressure, the coronary flow is so impaired, you know, you're not going to get adequate washing out of all that lactate. And so that's the kind of the principle behind, or the thought process behind, should we be quote unquote unloading these patients before you revascularize them? And back when I was a fellow, you know, it took, you know, maybe 2 minutes to put a balloon pump in, and it took almost 20 to 30 minutes to put an Impella in, because it was kind of, you know, we had to connect it to the module, set up the infusion port and do all sorts of things, versus now it takes like 2 to 3 minutes, you know, to get the Impella ready. So we're getting more and more comfortable. And actually, I encourage a lot of our general fellows who come in on STEMIs, you know, I mean, it's, you know, it's stressful. Patients are hypotensive. Our interventional fellows, depending on the level of experience, you know, we may or may not let the general fellows get access. But we say, listen, you should be able to prep the back table. You should be able to prep the Impella. You should be able to prep the balloon pump and be very facile at doing that. And if you can get it ready in 2 to 3 minutes, there's a strong argument to unload the patients ahead of time. And the thought is that their outcomes are better and their size of infarcts is less. So that is currently being investigated in a randomized controlled trial. You can imagine it is very tough to randomize an acute STEMI patient coming in to unload versus not load after or unload before. In other words, put a percutaneous assist device in before PCI versus after. But it is something that's being looked at, and there's a lot of basic science data and some early series to suggest that our practices may change in the next 5 years in terms of when you put these support devices in.
So we do have one final question. And so I think you talked about VSDs and mitral valve ruptures. And I think it sounds like the echo really does cinch the diagnosis. But prior to getting that echo, when you're just at the bedside, you're trying to figure out what's going on. Can you talk a little bit about the subtleties and the presentation of the both, what in the history can you use to kind of help gather and, you know, kind of leading up to you getting your echo and then probably calling your, well, obviously your attending is notified, but getting CT surgery on board and whatever.
Yeah, you know, I think it's very variable. You know, I've seen a fair number of post infarct VSDs and post you know, acute MI or some more subacute MI related mitral regurgitation, because I'm a structural heart cardiologist too. So I do percutaneous VSD closures and I do you know, mitral clips and other transcatheter therapies for the mitral valve. So my practice is selective, and I have seen a few number of these patients. And it's quite, you know, heterogeneous how these patients will come. They definitely don't feel well, so that's going to be a big one. They certainly don't. Their functional capacity is severely impaired. The vast majority I've seen, they've all been subacute presentations. Obviously, on cardiac examination, right, you're going to have a very loud thrill, kind of a left to right type murmur. If you have a VSD, you have that, you know, people talk about this classic apical murmur with radiation to the back when you have mitral regurgitation. But guess what? That's what the textbook says. In reality, a lot of our patients don't read the textbook. So if you have a you know, posterior flail with an anteriorly directed jet, you don't get that radiation in the axilla. If you have a VSD that's very anterior, you can hear it really loud. You get that thrill. And versus if you have an inferior MI and it's more posterior located VSD, the murmur trajectory and the sound is a little bit different. So they're very heterogeneous, you know. And I think, you know, when and one of the things as an attending when I'm on CCU, and also I encourage our fellows, you know, getting an echo is really, especially for a cardiologist in the CCU, should be as simple as pulling in a machine into the room and doing it yourself. You're not waiting for an echo tech. You're not, you know, when I ask my fellows, you know, what does the echo look like? You know, their response often is the echo hasn't been read. And I cringe a little bit because you are the cardiologist. So it, you know, getting an EKG, getting an echo should be, you know, part of the assessment in these critically ill patients, because it really does help quite a bit. And it helps speed up the assessment, especially with these complex structural heart complications, where the presentations can be varied. The physical exam, if the patient read the textbook, great. You know, it fits with your diagnosis, but a lot of patients don't. And so having that additional objective data, which I'm a huge fan of, you know, is really helpful.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Dr. Singh. We really appreciate it. Fantastic lecture, fantastic Q&A. We definitely appreciate your time and support.
Okay, fantastic. Good luck, everybody.
As a reminder, these lectures are posted on YouTube, the California ACC YouTube channel, as well as the California ACC website under the FIT subpage as well. So if you wanna, you know, take a look at it for the first time, if you're joining us for the recorded session, or to refresh for those of you joining us live, please go to that page and you'll be able to find it in the other sessions as well.
So do I get to tell my kids I'm like a YouTube star now?
Yes. Definitely.
All right. I'm pretty sure they'll be excited to watch it. Okay, guys. Take care.
Thank you. For next week, it will be Dr. David Donaldson of the University of California, Irvine, joining us. He'll be discussing atrial fibrillation. So we definitely look forward to this talk as well. And again, thank you all for joining us.
We'll see you guys next week, same time.
Thank you.